On this week's episode, we'll be giving you an introductory guide on OpenBSD's ports and packages system. There's also a pretty fly interview with Karl Lehenbauer about how they use FreeBSD at FlightAware. So we're going to have lots of interesting news and answers to all your emails this week on BSD Now, the place to be SD. BSD Now, episode 40, Airports and Packages, recorded June 4th, 2014. Hi, I'm your host, Chris Moore.
And I'm Alan Jude.
Well, glad to have you guys with us this week. We've got a lot of exciting news to go over, and still, you know, a couple weeks after BSD CAN, we have some wrap-up to jump right into for that. So first up, we want to mention that Talks and Reports Part 2 are available this week. So it looks like more presentations and trip reports. So I guess we were messing a few, Alan,
yeah,
that just got up this last week.
A couple of the videos needed some editing before they could post them. Mm-hmm. So they have those posted now. Ingo Suarez from OpenBSD has his talk on Mandoc, which is interesting, especially to me, as I've been learning how to write man pages the last couple of weeks. There's also the architecture of the new solver for the FreeBSD package system. This is the one that will make it so that we don't have to play with that updating file, and you can just seamlessly upgrade from Perl 5.12 to 5.16 or whatever.
Yeah, I really need to sit and parse that
one through. Exactly. That looks
like a big deal for me.
Julio Marino had his FreeBSD test suite talk, so that's a good one. And there's also transparent super pages for FreeBSD on ARM.
Oh, cool. Looks like our friend Michael Dexter also did a trip report.
Yep. So he was sponsored by the foundation to go to BSD CAN, so he has to submit a trip report and explain what he did there and what he saw and so on.
Sure. And then, of course, Warren Block also did one. So we got a couple different perspectives on how this last year's BSD CAN went.
Yep. And he has the requisite nod to Groff the BSD goat in there.
Of course. Yep. Man, keep rubbing it in, Alan. I'm still mad I didn't get to go this year. Curse you, United.
Yep.
But anyway, I'll move on. I'm getting over it.
But yes, both of those trip reports are nice and long and talk about all the different things they did at BSD CAN because there was a lot. It's like, you know, when we talked about the results the first day, the week after BSD CAN, we spent like half an hour talking about just what happened in the first 2 hours of the thing 2 days before the conference started.
Nice.
There was that much stuff going on. It was pretty crazy.
Yeah, and they get better every year. So looking forward to getting out there with you guys next year. I'll have to I'll just drive if I have to. Okay, you know, some more of this air travel junk. But yeah, well, cool. Well, that sounds like some neat wrap ups. I hope you guys enjoy reading through those. Yeah. And next up,
I also added the videos to that playlist I created last week. So I think that's all 24 videos are available now.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Excellent. So next up, we have an article about a Beyond Security, actually a YouTube video, but getting to know OpenBSD's real purpose.
Yes.
This is pretty cool here.
Yeah, our friend Michael W. Lucas gave a webcast through O'Reilly's about talking about what the real purpose of OpenBSD is beyond just the fact that it's nice and secure.
Sure. That's really cool. So this video on YouTube is going to clock in at just about a little over 30 minutes. He's going to go over a lot of OpenBSD topics. Some of which will include, you know, what is OpenBSD, why should you care, the philosophy of the project, how it serves as a pressure cooker for ideas, which that is very true. Briefly touches on some of the GPL versus BSDL and their do it right or don't do it all attitude, their stance on NDAs and blobs, which are pretty famous. Of course, recent Libre SSL developments got to be part of that as well. That's a lot of exciting stuff happening there. And some of the security functions that OpenBSD enabled before anyone else did and the ripple effect that had throughout the community. And of course, you know, we can't let any talk about OpenBSD go without, you know, mentioning their disturbing preference for Comic Sans as the default font. But we'll let that slide for now. Don't ask me about fonts, guys.
Yeah.
I have no preference. I don't care. As long as I can read it, I'm good. So we have in the show notes here, we'll have a direct link to the slides. You can take a look at that if you'd like to see it. Mm-hmm. And of course, it was a great presentation. Michael Lucas, a great guy and fun to hear talk. Yep. So if you would like to learn a little bit about OpenBSD, go ahead and click the link, take a look at that YouTube video and shoot your comments over to him too. I'm sure he'd love to hear back. Yep. Cool. So next up, we have another article this week about FreeBSD versus Linux, a comprehensive comparison. So I'll let you go ahead and you can dig into this one a little bit.
So this is another blog post covering something people seem to be obsessed with, FreeBSD versus Linux. This one's worth mentioning because it's very thorough and kind of digs into how things are done behind the scenes, not just the usual technical differences. So rather than just what you see as a user necessarily is the difference, but just how the teams are and or the system, well, everything is different.
Group dynamics and the way their commit systems work versus Linux. I mean, there's a lot of little subtle things, but without explaining those to somebody, you just wouldn't know. You assume.
And it highlights it was like Linux. It highlights the concept of the core team and how that's different than having someone like, say, a Linus or a Theo. And that's kind of prescient right now because we're in the middle of the core team election. It also talks about the roles of contributors versus committers and what the difference is there and how things work there and how you go from being a contributor to being a committer. You know, while there are a lot of things that are the same on both platforms, especially things like applications, which is actually what most people think of when they're thinking of Linux, what they're talking about isn't necessarily even Linux, just some application on top of Linux, like even if it's KDE or whatever. And
A lot of shows I go to, they don't know. They're just like, oh, when I say Linux, I mean Firefox and KDE.
Yeah, you
know?
It's like, well, all of those like, run on BSD just as well, if not better.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah.
So I guess they mentioned, of course, about a lot of things being the same on both platforms, but they'll also answer some of the questions, which one's right for me. And it kind of weighs in some of the points for both sides and different use cases. And TJ put a note in here too about it being a well-written, unbiased article that also mentions areas where Linux might be better. So don't hate us for linking it. You know, it's kind of in
the middle. It maybe it gives you the areas where you want to focus on making FreeBSD better.
Yep, definitely.
You know,
so the only bone I had to pick with them is they said firewalls. I don't see any mention of PF
their
FreeBSD. Yeah. They just said IP filter and IPFW. So anyway, whatever.
Yeah, that is weird because. PF is pretty awesome. Although IPFW is great. I wrote an article in it in the May-June article of the FreeBSD Journal.
I still use IPFW for traffic shaping and stuff.
I actually have the port WIPFW running on my Windows machine because I use DummyNet to simulate network, like a slower connection and stuff.
Latency and all that. Oh, that's pretty cool. So again, take a look at that article. Maybe give the writer a little bit of feedback, let them know we sent you.
For example, they have a section on access control, and they mention Unix permissions, but they don't mention the fact that FreeBSD has like ACLs and secure levels and Capsicum and all that stuff, or even just the auditing framework that it has.
Sure. Well, cool. Still an interesting article, so we encourage you to go read it, see what you think. So next up, we have another article cool this week about expanding FreeNAS with plugins. Which is a pretty neat and enjoyable article to read. But one of the things, of course, people love most about FreeNAS, other than ZFS, is their cool plugin framework. Yeah. So it becomes more than a NAS. This article is going to talk a lot about how you can use these plugins and greatly expand the feature set of your NAS via third-party apps, which aren't directly included with FreeNAS. Yep. So it's going to talk about some of the more popular ones, how they can improve your media box experience, for example. He goes through everything from own cloud servers to Bacula for backups. We got Plex Media Server, which I know the FreeNAS guys have told me is a huge one. Yep. So again, and it's very detailed. Screenshots, pictures, this is how you install, set it up, turn it on, configure, etc. So good article. Props to the author for writing that.
Exactly.
It's pretty good. To Jack Wallen, who's the author on that.
And if you're interested in actually making FreeNAS plugins, John Hickson gave a great talk at that at BSDCAN, so you can check out the video from last week's episode.
I think he's given that a couple places too. And I think at Asia BSDCon. So if that video is floating around, maybe there's some other detail there too. Yep. So yeah, definitely look into it. It's a neat thing and it's really cool to be able to do that on a headless box.
Yeah, and it'd be great to get even more of those built so that you can do even more great stuff with your FreeNAS.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. Well, cool. So after that article, that's a good segue into our sponsor for the week. Yep. Of course, iX Systems, right? Mm-hmm. But they have a cool new article up this week about their BSD CAN wrap-up. Craig Rodriguez, mm-hmm. I believe, went out there and wrote up a neat article on how that went, what he saw. He talked a little bit about the working group he did, continuous testing with Jenkins. So I gave everyone a status update on how the Jenkins system works in the FreeBSD cluster. And they also spent some time brainstorming future plans for expanding the use of Jenkins for a source and port builds, and how they could integrate testing with the continuous integration effort. Yep.
He also talked about setting up Ruby on Rails bug tracker under FreeBSD to get the Redmine bug tracker running under FreeBSD for the FreeNAS project, and maybe, you know, give other people that would be interested in doing that some of the tips on how to get it working and maybe to get that, make it easier with a port or whatever.
Cool. So definitely check that out. Again, that's just some of the stuff that IX does, sending these developers, sponsoring these conferences, getting BSD developers out where they can communicate with other users, sysadmins, and BSD developers. So a very worthwhile thing they're doing there. But of course, we want to mention the URL again, ixsystems.com/BSDnow. Go ahead and click that, log in, send, put in your information. You can download a guide on how to purchase a server for open source, what you should know before you pick your vendor, and what to ask your vendor when you're looking at prospective ones.
Exactly.
And of course, we can't, I mean, you've heard us week after week recommend IX Systems. There's you know, hardly much more we could say to say how awesome they are to work with. And they're going to put your needs first over what hardware they just have sitting
there's
around.
There's a reason I buy all of my hardware there.
Mm-hmm.
It isn't just because I know almost everybody that works there and they're great people. It's the fact that I get the server and it works as soon as I take it out of the box.
Well, yeah, and there's something to be said where when you call up and ask a BSD question, they don't go, BS what?
Exactly.
I mean, you can't put a price tag on that. Exactly. That's important when you're purchasing a new server, especially one you're going to spend maybe some serious coin on. It would be nice if they knew what you were going to do with it and how, you know, certain things you may pick in the hardware may affect performance or
exactly
how to get the most bang for your buck.
Well, you know, I'm building this giant ZFS server. Which type of SSD should I use for the L2 ARC and which for the ZIL? Because you actually don't necessarily want the same type of SSD for both. Yeah, the ZIL, you don't need as much space, but you want the performance. So, you know, you can end up getting one that's much more expensive per megabyte, but you don't, or per gigabyte, but you don't need as big a one. Whereas the L2 ARC, you want more, and you know, the endurance is a little bit less of an issue.
Mm-hmm. And of course, you know, they're going to be able to find the latest and greatest Intel processors for you and be able to recommend things that work well on BSD, have all the support you need. And never mind the fact they employ a lot of BSD, FreeBSD developers specifically, like, you know, obviously on FreeNAS and others. But
you know that sysETL I needed to make Beehive be able to use Zvols without the OS stealing the disk from it and stuff? Yeah, that came from someone that worked at IX because someone else needed it.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's just invaluable stuff. You're not going to get that at other big vendors I could mention who, again, would be kind of like BS what? And heck, let's be honest, even a lot of times their Linux is kind of like Linux what?
Exactly.
So, getting to a company like
guaranteed
that
to work with Windows
source.
Server 2003.
Yeah.
Because that's the last time we spec'd our hardware.
That's right. So, yeah, you can't put a value on being able to talk to a company that understands exactly what you're doing and, oh, you're going to be setting up Nginx on this and or serving this many files through Samba or NFS. Like, let's see how we can work with you to build a system that meets those specific needs. So, you know, me and Alan both can't recommend IX
Plus,
systems
you know,
enough. That's
white glove before and after you buy. You know, you get to talk to real people that actually know what they're talking about when you're looking to buy something. And then after you buy it, you always get the same treatment when you have a problem.
Yep, definitely. So cool. Again, that URL, ixsystems.com/BSDnow. Fill it out. Let them know that we sent you and that you heard it here on BSD Now. We'll be back in just a moment with our interview for the week.
Today on the show, we're joined by Karl Lehenbauer from FlightAware. Thank you for coming on the show.
Thanks, Alan.
And I guess the first question we always ask people is, how did you get started with BSD?
Well, actually, found out about 386 BSD and downloaded it over the internet at 9600 baud. So I spent 24 hours downloading it. I loaded it onto however many floppies it took, a huge number, copied that onto a 386SX, booted it up, and it worked, and I was hooked.
That's great. So I guess tell us a little bit about FlightAware.
Sure. FlightAware, we started it 9 years ago. It was a hobby. We had another business. We're trying to do software for the cable TV industry. And a couple buddies of mine and I got a feed from the FAA, which they make available to industry, FedEx, American Airlines, stuff like that. We just started looking at this data stream and you know, read the documentation and began to parse it began to try to make sense of it. And then we just started creating, putting it in a SQL database and making a website that could access it. And then that kind of ballooned and took off, and that became a business.
Cool. So it uses FreeBSD. Can you tell us a little bit about how you use FreeBSD?
Well, we use FreeBSD everywhere. Our database servers, 500 gigs of RAM, 32 processors, FreeBSD. Web servers are blades in a blade chassis, FreeBSD. Lots of various machines doing various things, just whatever it is, it's pretty much going to be FreeBSD.
Right. So in your keynote, you mentioned that you keep all of the data you get ever. So you use ZFS for that?
Yeah, we do. That's the thing we did started early on, is every message that we receive, we store in the native format. And what happened is, a lot of times those messages are really complicated, and they, you know, we interpret them, and over time we began to understand our interpretations get better. And it turned out that, you know, if we were only keeping our interpretations, then we actually lost fidelity. So we like to keep the original message. It's also great too to look back at a problem or something like that and say, hey, here's this message for this flight, you departed from the wrong airport or whatever.
Right. Back to the source. In your keynote, you mentioned that the FAA marks flights as canceled when they arrive.
Yeah, that's really common. And it actually, you know, if you're like making a visual approach to an airport, like the weather's really good, it's not like you're on the instrument flight rules all the way down to the ground. So there's a point that you actually cancel the normal sort of flight tracking and the services that they provide. Maybe you're 1 mile from the airport, and yeah, it would always, on competitor sites, it would be canceled, 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 canceled. Now we say, hey, canceled means canceled. We're going to call that arrived.
Right.
Yeah.
Because, you know, if somebody's checking the flight, if somebody's waiting for it to arrive at the airport, and all of a sudden it says canceled, it's like, oh, well, I don't have to go to the airport.
Yeah, they're going
to
think something's wrong.
Exactly.
And so that's one of the things we did, is trying to adapt what the messages were saying to the terminology of everyday people.
Right.
And meeting their expectations.
Do you guys make any changes to FreeBSD, or does it just work out of the box for you?
I made some changes a long, long time ago. I was working on FreeBSD at an ISP and working with a serial data card, like a T1 card, and I saw a way to detect if the circuit was looped and let it log that, and I submitted some driver changes. And I collected patches at the very beginning of 386BSD. I was one of the patch aggregators.
Right.
But now, we have a number of open source projects that we work on, but we haven't actually made changes to FreeBSD.
Right.
I'd like to, I just don't need to.
Yeah, so. I guess you guys have a couple of blog posts about some tuning, and that's about it.
Yeah, we do tend to push it. You know,
right.
Like machines with 500 gigs of RAM, definitely try to make the mbuffs large and make the shared memory segments really large.
Right.
If it's a database server and things like that.
Postgres?
Yes. And we like Postgres a lot.
Yes.
And we like FreeBSD a lot.
Yeah.
And we like them together.
Mm-hmm. Which web server do you use?
Apache.
Huh?
And so we use the Apache, and we have a module for it called Rivet. It was actually invented by a guy named David Weldon, but we've contributed to it. It's a Tickle scripting module. So the web pages a lot are generated with Apache, with embedded Tickle, and then they're making requests back to the database, and they're making requests to these memory resident caches and things like that. That we
do. Cool. Is there anything else you can tell us about?
Well, it's actually a really hard problem. It's kind of surprising. We've been at it for 9 years. I didn't think I would be at it this long. And I thought at first that the problem was solvable, and it isn't. In fact, the normal sort of Boolean logic you can't do that. You can't kind of sit there and say, if the plane is this close to the destination and there's a cancel message we have to do a lot more kind of fuzzy logic. We score things. I'm trying to match one flight plan to another. Well, the departure time is off, but the origin and the destination are the same, and the arrival time is the same, and so I think those are the same. So it turns out, like, the more we learn about it, the more complicated the problem gets. Now we're working with satellite tracking providers, with other countries, with their air traffic control data that they send us, a lot of different formats.
Different format, yeah.
Absolutely, different formats, different different, completely different philosophies, even in how they provide the data, how it's not just formats, but like in some cases it's more of a projection, in other cases it's absolutely a position. We've built our own little telemetry boxes that we have all over the world, about 400, that can pick up a kind of transmission from modern aircraft called ADS-B, which is Airborne Dependent Surveillance Broadcast. And that's a way that airplanes will deconflict each other in the future, and they'll be able to provide their own, sort of do some of their own, manage their flight path. Whereas right now that's all done by air traffic controllers, but they foresee a day where you and I are flying our jets and we're on flight plans that we've programmed into our computers, and my plane wants to descend and your plane wants to descend, and we're going to actually be in conflict with each other, and then my plane and your plane will agree, and my plane will just say, well, I'll just wait 10 seconds and then you descend 1,000 feet underneath me and then I descend, and it tries to be fair. It's really cool stuff. I think it'll be a long time before it's standard and widespread, but it's very, very interesting, and it works where there isn't radar.
Right.
And the radar stations are very, very expensive to maintain. And then, of course, you get out over the mountains and you don't have it. So
yeah.
There's a lot of innovation in the industry, and any opportunity really to leverage software, because there's so much aviation and there's so much money being spent to operate these aircraft and stuff, when you can cause the plane to operate more efficiently, to take a better route, to begin its descent sooner and descend through an airspace where you used to not allow that to occur because it would incur on other aircraft, but you'd like to descend with the engines idling,
right,
and just make a nice descent, not have to throw out the brakes and all that energy that you spent getting up to 7 miles of altitude, being, scrubbing that up, instead just let that thing glide in. Mm-hmm. So it's fascinating. It's 9 years of my life, and it's something that I don't see an end in sight to. So I'm going to continue going.
Yeah, lots of interesting things. And do you see a lot of spikes in traffic? Obviously, recently with all the weather and then the mess in Chicago, caused, a huge number of flights to be canceled. Does that cause a big spike in kind of demand on you guys?
Yeah. In fact, at the beginning, when we were really small, we started with a single 1U server, mm-hmm, and then we bought a little database server that by today's standards was really wimpy, but by then we were very proud of it.
Mm-hmm.
Greta Van Susteren said FlightAware on CNN and our server crashed.
Yeah.
All they had to do was say the word FlightAware and we would crash. And now they can, NBC Nightly News or something can do a piece and talk about us, and we see a spike in the traffic, but it doesn't take us out at all.
Right.
We normally are doing during the day about 250 web pages a second, and when there's a huge storm or something and we're getting a lot of media attention, we can do two or three times that.
Yeah. And you do that all on your own hardware as well?
Yeah, we do that. Well, we use a content delivery network.
Okay.
But so simple things like the images and things like that, intermediate pieces of certain pages and stuff. But the site is in 15 languages.
Okay.
If you're logged in, you get a customized experience. So the CDN only goes so far. And
right,
we generate all the rest of it with our own hardware.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Is there anything else, I guess?
I think that FreeBSD is probably, or BSD, the parent, is, to me, the finest operating system I've ever seen. And it has, despite not having the backing, like how IBM backs Linux and all
right,
these companies put all this money into Linux, the quality that they started with, the quality of the people who are working on it, the rigor of the engineering process, FreeBSD never seems to run out of steam.
Yes, and I guess that was something we talked about at the 20th anniversary, as Kirk Bogusik mentioned. As far as measuring the success of open source projects, one of the metrics is, can it survive a change of leadership?
Yeah.
And the FreeBSD project has survived the most changes of leadership of any open source project.
I didn't know that. That's really interesting.
Because they have an election system and a core group.
Right, that's how you have to do it. Because people, their lives change, their goals change, their purposes change. They get started on something else, or they start a family or something, and I can't act like I used to be able to, or whatever. And then that someone else can pick that up. It's really powerful. It's completely exciting, and it's a completely strong piece of software, and it's one that I expect that we will be able to continue to use for the entire time that we're doing FlightAware.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Okay. Thank you.
All right.
And we're back on BSD Now, getting ready to go into our weekly news roundup. But first, of course, we want to mention the other sponsor this week, Tarsnap. Mm-hmm. Of course, that website is tarsnap.com/BSD Now. And we want to mention something too. It's available, obviously, for FreeBSD, but it's also available for many, many other platforms.
Yep, I mean, including all the other BSDs, Linux, yeah. OS X, Minix, OpenIndiana, and Cygwin.
Yeah, I mean, even Cygwin, yeah, so if you want to do some Windows stuff.
Pretty much anything that will run Unix-like code will run the Tarsnap client. You know, it doesn't have support for Windows unless you're using Cygwin, and it does not have a graphical user interface. But if you've ever used Tar, you can use Tarsnap, and it's the best and most secure way to back up your files.
Yep. So a couple things I want to mention, though, if you look at the news on their page, I think we've mentioned this before, but they now have Bitcoin support.
Yep.
So you can even pay via Bitcoins, which kind of fits along with the whole cryptographic backup that you're doing with Tarsnap. And that's actually kind of cool that Colin's doing that now.
Yep. And also the code for the client is open so that you can review it.
Yep.
And there is a bug bounty.
How much is the bounty on that?
Depends. If you find a cosmetic error, you get $1.
Yay.
If you find a bug which allows someone to intercept Tarsnap traffic, you get $1,000.
Nice. So I'm pretty sure it's pretty secure. You think people would find those bugs if they wanted that money.
But
that is really cool. So, of course, we can't recommend Tarsnap enough. Colin, the guy who authors this, great guy, and truly understands what cryptography is about and why you need to trust your backups is something where the people on the other side don't have access to what's getting sent over the wire.
They don't just promise not to look at your files.
Yeah.
It's technically impossible for them to look at your files. Yeah.
And, promises are only so good because, I mean, you can promise and then still get hacked.
Yep.
Somebody could break in, malicious employee, you name it.
Yeah, something exactly. Can Dropbox can promise and then some employee does something they're not supposed to.
Yeah. But with the way Tarsnap's designed, its architecture, that can't happen.
Exactly.
An FBI agent cannot walk into Colin's office and be like, give me this user's files. I can't. I don't know what they are. I have no access to that. It's all encrypted.
I don't even know what the file names are.
Yep. No clue. So, again, look at Tarsnap. Online backups for the truly paranoid. And let's face it, I mean, it pays to be a little paranoid in today's day and age. So, cool. Okay. Well, let's head into our weekly news roundup. Yep. So, first up, code review culture meets FreeBSD. So, of course, in most of the BSDs, maybe a difference from some other open source projects, changes need to be reviewed by more than one person before being committed to the tree. So, the article we're going to link to today is describing Fabricator, an open source code review system that we briefly mentioned last week.
Yep.
I think you have a picture of it to show already.
Well, here's a live view of here's somebody's making IPFW, the firewall, use the table names internally. And so you can see that it was originally posted here by this user. And they have a list of people that are subscribed to it, so they'll find out every time there's a change and so on. Mm-hmm. And then down here, you can see the actual diff. And people can make inline comments in the diff. So just by clicking on a line number, you can leave a comment about, I think here that, this should be done differently. Or, when I was working on a man page, someone was like, I think Ethernet should be capitalized there. Or, whatever it is. And it allows you to... Yeah, so here's a bunch of comments. You can see that they're checking. It's like, is this change on purpose? Because it changes behavior. It looks here that it's actually...
Yeah, there was a mistake here.
And I fixed it. And it goes back and forth, and then they can post future updates until the diff gets all the way through the review process. And once everybody's happy with it, you'll see currently there's no reviewers listed for this one, but if there are some, the names will be there with a little circle beside them. And then that circle will have, an X if they found a problem, or a check mark if they think it's ready to go into the tree.
Mm-hmm. That's really cool. And, it's a neat system.
Yeah, so it has a couple of different modes. This one is called the differential and allows you to post a diff, get it reviewed before it goes in. There's also an audit. So after a commit goes in, you can also go in and point out a problem with it through this system. And then that gets red flagged, and it goes through, and then it goes away once it's been fixed.
Cool. So we'll have links here too. There's instructions for using it on the FreeBSD wiki now. You can take a look at, kind of walk you through it. And of course, he mentions that this is not approved by the core team yet for anything official, but it's in its testing phase, and developers are encouraged to try it out and get your patches reviewed. I mean, what's it going to hurt having a set of eyeballs look at it and just make sure that everything's the way it should
be? Currently, the way that most of the review happens is sending diff by emails or whatever, and that's great, but it's often hard to find that review after the fact. You know, oftentimes it's direct emails between some developers, not on a mailing list, and so it doesn't go into the archives. Whereas with Fabricator, it'll just be all there in a database, and you can go back and actually see the review happening after the fact. And, you know, even just have something to point at to say that, yes, this went through all this review before it went into the tree.
And the one thing we got to point out, you know, it's nice to have one that actually looks good and has a good interface. Yeah. Just because it's a development tool doesn't mean it's got to suck as far as how it looks. You know? Fabricator looks really nice and very easy to use. So. Yep.
Speaking of that, we don't actually have it in the news roundup, but the big news this week was over the weekend, FreeBSD switched from using the NATS bug reporting system to using Bugzilla. And so that's thanks to Eaton Adler and Peter Wehman and all the other people who put a lot of work into making that happen. It seems to be working very well so far.
Cool. Yeah, I've definitely seen there's a lot of chatter on the mailing list. Some people getting used to how that's going to work.
Yes, I have actually have a patch in Fabricator right now updating the documentation to explain how to submit a bug using Bugzilla instead of NATS.
Nice.
And that's going back and forth as we as it evolves.
Cool. Okay, well, next up, we, of course, want to mention Michael Lucas, which we mentioned a little earlier on the show. He's got his next tech books under development. We'll have a link to a post he put up here, but somehow he found a way to get two mentions on our show this week. I don't know what's up with that, but good work, Michael. Mm-hmm. He gives us an update on the next BSD book he's planning to release. Yeah. So I guess the plan is to release three or so books based on different aspects of FreeBSD storage systems, starting with Geom, UFS, ZFS, etc. So that's really cool to get books specifically targeting some of these neat areas, especially for heavy users and developers. So this has the advantage of requiring you only to buy the ones you're specifically interested in. So if you're an all ZFS shop, you can grab a ZFS book and you don't have to ignore the UFS chapters or vice versa. Of course, if you want to get into the nitty-gritty and go down to Geom, you can get into that too. Yep. So of course, he answers the question, when will they be released? And that's when he's done with them, when he's done writing them. That's such a Blizzard answer, by the way, Michael. Oh, when it's done. Yes. Whatever.
He was saying that, you know, apparently his innocent questions can blow up the mailing list because he asked a question and then there started a whole discussion about how, yes, that doesn't work like it should. It should be done this way. Mm-hmm. But no, maybe we should do it this way.
Yep. So when asked how much they will cost, he responded with, I don't know. So
I'm guessing
we'll find out to at his some point.
Previous books about the $10 mark, but
yeah. So of course, when we get those details, we will pass them along. And he also mentions that this is not absolute FreeBSD third edition. So just to make that clear,
and he's like, "How many will there be?" And he's like, "Definitely a positive integer of some kind."
Yes, definitely. Well, cool. Okay, next up, we have a video here on YouTube talking about carp failover and high availability on FreeBSD. Yep. So, of course, if you're running a cluster or group of servers, you probably should have some kind of failover in place. That's pretty much a no-duh. But the question comes up, you know, how do you balance the load balancers? So this video is going to go through the process of giving, you know, more than one machine the same IP, how to set up CARP, you know, how to make it secure, demonstrates what happens when a node dies, and it's also going to go through some of the DNS-based load balancing as another option. So, pretty good stuff there.
Yeah. So it just actually walks you through the steps of setting up CARP and watching it actually move the shared IP address between the different machines as they fail and then come back up.
Nice.
Yep. It also mentions a little bit of DNS-based load balancing at the end there. And if you're interested in that, you can see my talk from EuroBSD Con 2012 probably the one from 2013 as well, as it mostly focuses on using DNS load balancing to mitigate denial of service attacks, but it's still very useful information, and gets into adding more complicated stuff into your DNS load balancing setup.
Yep.
In the case of the denial of service one, it was you know, how busy is the network card on the server, but you can also apply any other business rules you might have.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Okay, well, this week we also have a PCBSD Weekly Digest. So a couple things we want to mention there. We're getting ready for 10.02 release. That's our quarterly release. We're targeting probably mid-June-ish, so 2-3 weeks is what it looks like. And we're asking folks to help test. We've already posted some stuff to the mailing list, and we'll have a link in the show notes here where you can download new ISOs for it. If you're running 10.01 or 10.0 and you've switched to the Edge package set, you're already on 10.02, so test it. If you find problems, you know, we need to know about it in the next couple of weeks, especially anything critical, you know, the kind of stuff that stops a window manager from working, or you can't install, or even applications in the ports tree that are bad and need a fix. Like, get that stuff into us as soon as possible. Yep. And I'll mention that our website for that is track.pcbsd.org, and file a bug report. That way we make sure it doesn't get lost in the shuffle and can address that. Also, the App Cafe got a lot of fixes this last week. We now show different highlighted applications every time you start it. So things that we maybe recommend from the project perspective, and then other popular apps you may want to consider for whatever your workload is. We've also added some new tools to create bulk PBIs from entire FreeBSD port categories. That's the Easy PBI utility. Okay. And Lumina, the new desktop environment we've been working on, has also gotten some fixes in time for 10.02 and some new work in place. So check that out. We love feedback and comments and ways we can improve it. So, of course, send that in. We got an email a little earlier, right before the show, somebody asking about when the PackageNG App Cafe switch was happening. And I'll go ahead and let you know. I mean, it's in Edge right now. That's what's going to be included in 10.02 in a couple weeks. So if you want to switch to it now, switch to the Edge package set via the Control Panel Package Manager, and then do an update. And after you update, the first time you run App Cafe, it'll convert you over to the new PackageNG stuff. Nice. And you are ready to roll at that point. You're on the right track. And of course, that'll go out officially for all the production users in the next couple weeks.
Nice.
Cool. So a lot of stuff. Oh, that new ISO has also got the full disk encryption with Jelly and Grub.
So it prompts for the password in Grub so that you don't have the password prompt get buried under your USB keyboard.
Slight note on that. It asks you a second time for the password still. The FreeBSD kernel, we don't have it where we can pass the password.
Okay, from Grub, so it's just so that you don't need the unencrypted partition.
Yeah. The whole point is the old way you used to have to do full disk encryption on FreeBSD was you'd have your encrypted part, which is like your root and all your files, but you'd still need a second partition somewhere.
With your slash kernel boot, that would actually just have enough to get it started.
But the risk there was, I mean, you still end up with an unencrypted part of your system.
Yes, so specifically the kernel, which isn't being protected from being tampered with.
I mean, if somebody screws up your loader or screws up your kernel or slips a
rootkit in there or something,
malicious module in there or something, you wouldn't know until after you typed your password in.
Yeah.
That's a problem. Exactly. So this new method allows everything, including boot, to be encrypted, so we can be sure that nobody's just going to wander by your laptop the next time you leave it sitting somewhere at a conference and then decide to do something, you know, nasty to it. So we'll need testing on that. That just went in a couple weeks ago. Please try that out. Let us know how it works.
Yes.
In addition, we put some stuff in there where you can now assign a ZIL device or L2 ARC drive during install. Nice. So if you have like a small SSD or something and you want to assign it to the L2 ARC, you can do that. You don't have to do it post-installation. So again, all things that need testing because they've gone in here soon.
Yeah, for using the L2 ARC, have you guys looked at adjusting the write throttle on the L2 ARC?
We haven't done any tuning of it yet. This literally just went into the installer. The tuning will come as we find the time for it. But of course, we're going to be borrowing some of the stuff from FreeNAS on that. They've done a lot of work on tuning these particular cases, and they have Drew Levine, who's doing the docs, is even borrowing some of that from FreeNAS because they have a lot of good recommendations on if you're going to use a ZIL or use an L2 ARC, this is how you want to do it. She said something about even using bigger SSDs created worse performance. So they've done all the performance testing and found that if you're going to do it, this is the best way.
Your L2 ARC needs RAM for every block that you have in the L2 ARC. So if you don't have a lot of RAM, using a really large L2 ARC will actually take away most of your primary ARC as backing for the L2 ARC and could actually, result in worse performance.
Yes. So all those things will be going into our docs as well now to reflect those things. So check out the documentation. Yeah. We have a pretty stinking good handbook, and credit goes to Drew Levine for that. And of course, the other documenters who work on the wiki, which you can help with too. So if you find something, create a wiki account, start adding it. Drew will take a look at it and we'll we'll get it all in the next version of the handbook that gets included on the desktop when somebody installs. Yep.
And I see you also have a note here about the boot environment stuff. I've got bitten by that one a couple of times.
Yes. Boot environments, there was a nasty bug we figured out just this last week. If you deleted the first boot environment, you could screw up your loader.
Yeah, I guess the loader in the grub.conf, the way it loads the fonts and stuff uses whichever was the default when you created the first boot environment or whatever.
Yeah, well, it was a little worse than that. So what happens is the way grub works for ZFS, the first boot environment or data set that's created, it uses that to figure, there's a small file with a UUID that gets passed and says, here's the data set to load the grub.cfg file from.
Yeah.
So if that data set goes bye-bye because you deleted it, it horks and it can't go anywhere at that point. It
doesn't have to drop menus. I think the way I've had to do it was run the grub-install on the partition after every time I used the utility to modify it.
So we patched our grub make config utility to do that, where if you've deleted a boot environment, if you're removing, say, the default one or any of them, it makes sure it's going to restamp that grub install so that it can load from a valid partition. Yes. That fixes it.
I guess the other thing was that when you deleted the default or the one that it was loading the modules from, it didn't have the ZFS module and then nothing worked.
It's like, oh no.
Yeah.
So that was it. That was a good fix, which was an important one for us because I know we're talking a lot about PCBSD here, but another cool thing we put in this last week was automatic boot environment creation. So anytime you start an update that may be like package related, FreeBSD update related, or a standalone patch, maybe we've issued a patch to fix something with a utility, it's going to automatically create a boot environment beforehand.
Yes.
So in the off chance something goes wrong, you lose power in the middle of it, a package can't install properly, no harm done. You can boot in the old boot environment and you don't have to hit yourself afterwards like, oh, I forgot to create one. It does that automatically and it prunes them as well. I think the default is set to 5 it'll keep, so you have the 5 most recent updates you can boot back into. Right. And that's only for automatic. Anything you've manually created, we're not going to touch that until you're ready to delete it. But I'm going to put some tuning in there here soon too, so you can say, I want to keep the last 10 updates I did or whatever, which is important, especially if you're running an Edge package set and you maybe upgrade KDE and go, oh, this feature I needed, doesn't work the way it used to, or I want the old one back.
Or doesn't work at all or whatever.
Or doesn't work at all. I mean, you never know. Sometimes an NVIDIA driver may break one particular class of cards and it's like, I need to roll back. So we can do all that for you automatically now.
It didn't bite me. Everything worked. Mm-hmm. But about 10 seconds after typing make install world on a production server to upgrade it to the latest head after the security announcements, I was like, I should have created a snapshot first.
Yeah. Because boot environments are still relatively new, ZFS.
Yeah.
So it's like we don't have those muscle memory yet I should always create the snapshot first or the boot environment.
Literally it's like 10 seconds too late. I'm like, crap.
Oh, crap. Yeah. And by that point, it's like you said, too late.
Yeah. So. Luckily, everything worked and it wasn't a problem, but it was just like, oh, damn.
Yeah. Well, hey, I'll mention too, since we talked about encryption, the boot environments work with Jelly encryption. That was another critical piece for us. I wanted boot environments to work regardless of whether you had encrypted, root or not. And it does. And that's really stinking cool. Yeah. I think that may be a first in the OS world that we have boot environments with encryption and full disk and all that. Yeah. I got to check out Solaris does that if they do.
Yeah, but I know they do. Solaris really had a full disk encryption option.
Yeah, I don't know.
They have ZFS encryption now, but.
Yeah. But I don't think that's like full disk. Like,
no, it's like they have the ZFS encryption that isn't the one that it was promised to be or whatever.
Yeah. Anyway, we'll give ourselves props on that. Yep. That's pretty cool that we've got that working now. Okay, we'll be back in just a moment with weekly feedback and questions. So hang tight. Okay, and we're back with our first feedback for the week, coming from Paul. So the description or the comment here was UFS corruption. So he said he recently set up a small FreeBSD 10.0 release P3 32-bit system running with an OpenStack instance KVM. He says it's a very light-duty system using UFS with just a static website under Nginx and PostFix for mail, both running in jails. Some unknown event occurred that corrupted the file system beyond repair. He says he has full backups. The data loss is irrelevant. It is an event that caused the corruption that's worrisome, naturally. So he said when he found the system, it was sitting at the loader prompt complaining, don't know how to load module boot kernel, can't load kernel. He says he has no idea how it got there. He said he tried to, he has a copy of the corpse and has been searching through it crudely, trying to find hints as to what happened, but so far finding nothing that jumps out at me. Says he has two questions. Is there any other logging or state information beyond that which you find in var log that might have been stored by the kernel or some service that he didn't configure explicitly just before things went south? He said he can find some of the var log disk image, but most of the valuable logs are not to be found, probably like var log messages, demessage, etc. The logs that do remain show nothing out of the ordinary. He said he did find shell history logs for the hosts and all the jails, but there was nothing he didn't do myself in any of them. So he didn't have his system configured for a crashed up, although maybe that would have helped in this case.
Well, it's usually configured almost automatically. So if you can look at the swap and see if there's anything there, then there might be a crash dump, but
maybe. But he said also, assuming this is a bug and not an attack that was effectively covered up, do you have any other suggestions as to what I could do to help find the cause? He said he's changed the system to log everything remotely, but other than perhaps enabling UFS journaling and or turning off auditing, nothing is really else is obvious to him. He said he may have screwed up, but he's tried to be very careful with some design of the system. I lean more towards it being a bug somewhere. So a couple comments on that. I mean, if you can do the journaling, turn it on, see if that helps for sure. I mean, we used to do everything on UFS before ZFS came along for desktops. And I know in particular laptops, if it gets shut down improperly or loses power at just the wrong moment, you can have bad stuff happen. Usually FSCK would fix it.
But it would take like an hour or more. Yeah, whereas
it would take forever. I assume you've tried that. So this is non-fixable by FSCK, is very concerning.
I'm kind of wondering like what FSCK says or what anything the tools say.
I'm looking for some other errors.
Yeah.
Yeah, because you'd think FSCK would at least complain about a bad block.
I guess the problem he's having is that he's not getting past the loader in order to get far enough to do something. Is a virtual machine, I don't know how easy it is. With like OpenStack, I don't know how easy it is to boot off a live CD to actually have some tools and poke at it.
Yeah, I was going to say, if you could poke at it a little, maybe get us just some output from those commands. Yeah. That would at least point you in the right direction and kind of figure out what happened. I assume you said you've been able to try and mount it because you've been looking for logs.
Yeah.
But again, you just didn't say anything about FSCK, so I don't know if that was tried yet or not. Yeah, but journaling would be a good one. So,
which is on by default in the 10 installer, so unless he manually disabled it, it would have been on.
Yeah, yeah. I assume that would be, maybe it was on purpose because there's some reason you don't want journaling, but that would be one place I would start with anyway for the next attempt. Any other thoughts, Alan?
It also depends how your OpenStack is set up. If you're storing to a remote system, there's always a chance something else went hinky in the middle there, but it's really hard to say without an error other than that the loader couldn't load the kernel.
Yeah. I mean, something happened, but I mean, if you can send me more info in, that would be helpful.
Like, he's saying about the file system being corrupted, but you know, that error could just mean that the kernel file was deleted or something.
Yeah, and that, like a bad upgrade or something in the file,
and everything else was fine. Because like that could have been caused by accidentally installed an AMD 64 kernel somehow. I doubt that would have happened, Yes. Maybe if you can give us more information, that'd be something we could take a look at.
Cool. Okay, next up we have a comment from Matt about jailing services.
Yes, he says, in the near future, he's going to migrate his home server from FreeBSD 9.2 and desktop hardware to a new server with an 8-core processor and run FreeBSD 10. He says, currently I have all my applications running on the host OS, but with this migration, I'd like to move them all into jails. The applications I'm running are Murmur, which is the Mumble server. It's a voice chat. That works great in a jail. I happen to be running that in a jail. So he says two instances of transmission. Again, those will work. You might want to nullfs mount the file system that you're actually writing your torrents to or whatever so that you can access it other places. Zone Minder? I don't know what that is.
Mm-mm.
Yeah.
Not off the top of my head.
Myth TV, you might have trouble if you're trying to actually access a capture card. It depends what you're using Myth TV for. Sickbeard and Plex. Again, with those, you're probably going to want to use some shared file system somewhere that you mount into your torrent jail and your Sickbeard and your Plex and maybe your own cloud so that your Plex can access your torrents or whatever.
So ZoneMinder is for security and surveillance camera stuff.
Now, if it's trying to access a camera, it may have trouble running in a jail. You might have to look at the DevFS rules to actually expose the camera devices into the jail because they're not there by default.
Yep.
And he asks, would it be best to split them up into separate jails? That's usually the point. Although certain ones, if you need them to share information,
or not.
Like, yeah, you, it might actually make sense to put your transmission, Sickbeard, Plex, and OwnCloud into one jail or something if you want them to all share the same files. But you can do those separately and then just have a shared directory that you nullfs mount into all of them.
So I'd say like ZoneMiner, MythTV, those guys that need to access those cards, you could, if they're not having any forward-facing interfaces out to the web, you could throw them in a single jail, run them that way. If they're all used internally.
Yeah. But yes, you should be able to do them all in separate jails. He says he has 6 3-terabyte drives in a RAID Z2, which is a good configuration. He said he'd like to keep this as is. And yes, it would just be as simple as doing Zpool export on the original system, moving the drives over to the new one, and doing Zpool import. Now, depending how you have that set up, if you have like root on ZFS install, then when you try to import it, it's going to mount the slash from the 9.2 over top of the 10, which probably isn't what you want. So when you do Zpool import, you probably do minus O alt root equals slash MNT or something, and that'll bring it. And then you can do ZFS rename and ZFS set mount point and whatever you need to do to wiggle stuff around to get it to be where you want it to be.
Mm-hmm.
Or if it's a brand new system, I guess the way you would do it is move the drives, boot off of it on the new system, and then upgrade from 9.2 to 10, and then go from there. It says, the OS is on a single UFS formatted drive. Oh, well, then he's not using root on ZFS. Yeah. So then, yes, you can just import it, and it'll work great. He said he'd like to move that to a bigger SSD on ZFS as well. You can use separate pools, or you can not. Depends. Honestly, with an SSD, having the OS on it is great, but sometimes I feel like I could get more performance using the SSD for other stuff. And, you know, the OS starts once and then just sits there, right?
Yeah.
But, yeah, if your stuff is already in jails, it's super easy to migrate. I always love that, you know? Yeah, especially if you're using Easy Jail, because then you just Easy Jail stop it, Easy Jail archive, move it, Easy Jail create from an archive, and boom, you've just done a cold migration of a jail from one machine to another. And because it abstracts the base jail, you know, you can move it from a 9.2 to a 10 system. Just when you go to start the jail again, you'll have to upgrade the packages inside so they'll be compiled against 10 instead of 9. Although I have cheated temporarily before and just installed compat 9x, which makes the apps work anyway.
That works. That works.
But that's really not the recommended way to do it. But yeah, cool. So really your only considerations are using manual nullfs mounts to share files between jails, you know, between your Sickbeard and your Plex or whatever. And if you're using Easy Jail, you'll have an etc fstab.jail name, and you can just add the line in there so that it'll automatically create the nullfs mount when you start the jail and unmount it when you stop the jail. And then the other one is the devfs rules to expose the camera or to ZoneMinder or the capture card to MythTV or whatever else you might need. But yeah, that's about all there is to it. Cool. Jails are awesome.
Okay, next question we have is about router hardware. So Kijel says, hi, from my recent successful attempt with R domains at work, I now want to change my topology and use 3 OpenBSD routers, one for each /24 network. However, a colleague of mine is skeptical of the reliability of normal hardware versus Cisco equipment that he's used to. So what kind of hardware would you recommend to have the most reliable routers? Do you have any preference on that, Alan?
The best way would be to just have 2 pieces of hardware and carp them. Because no matter what, there's always a chance something will fail. But if you have 2 of them, you no longer have a single point of failure. And then it makes it much easier to just use cheap stuff. I was thinking, it was like, well, you know, I use a server that has dual power supplies. And then I was like, but, you know, there's still other things. And the other advantage
RAM could go bad, motherboard.
Yeah, and also the other advantage of just having a carp like that is when it's time to upgrade OpenBSD, you just upgrade one and reboot it. And then, you know, you can let it run for a couple days, make sure it's all stable before you upgrade the other one. And, you know, people don't have any downtime with it. Especially OpenBSD also has PF sync, which allows you to sync the NAT state table between your 2 or 3 routers with carp. And the advantage there is that it means that even when you fail over to the other device, it already has the state. So users behind it don't even miss out on translation packets and so on. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I wouldn't say that Cisco equipment is any more reliable than normal hardware, but
mm-hmm. but there's ways you can do this to
you
make
might
it
actually be
uber reliable.
You might be better off using two cheap pieces of hardware than trying to spend all your money on one that is supposedly
could
more
just
reliable
as easily fail.
Yeah. It's maybe less likely to fail, but it still has a chance to fail, whereas two machines mm-hmm. has a lot less chance that they'll both fail at the same time.
Sure. Cool. Okay. Well, next up, question from Paul about a developer tutorial. So what's he got here, Alan?
He says he's requested a developer tutorial that he would like to see for the show. Up to this point, the tutorials have focused on administering a server, which has been extremely valuable to him as he enjoys controlling his own cloud, and he has a rack in his basement full of stuff. And he hopes that our trend towards, you know, talking about server stuff continues. However, he's also like to dabble in programming, especially in C and C++ and Objective-C. And, you know, he's currently reading K and R and a bunch of other big tech books. And he's mm-hmm. seriously contemplated elevating his career from being an IT generalist to being more of the DevOps type thing.
He says he guess he loves pain. You might a little,
and
but it's a good pain.
And he'd like to see how the BSD pros like Chris do some of that stuff.
Well,
or you know,
to be honest, my workflow is pretty boring. Yeah. it's VI. Yeah.
So he'd like to use tools to develop cool BSD software. You know, what IDEs or frameworks, and like how do you do stuff in Qt? Mm-hmm. Deal with repositories like SVN and Git, and all that kind of stuff. From all the different BSD projects. So, do you have any mm-hmm. thoughts there?
So, yeah, as I said, I mean, my main workflow is pretty much VI for anything and everything except for doing UI development. Since we use Qt, I love Qt. It's a great toolkit. I use their designer utility just to generate the raw UI files because it's just easier to point and click and drag, and okay. this is how I want this UI to look, instead of trying to visualize it in my head and do it in VI and then writing all the weird XML or doing it by hand in C++. That's a little harder. So I use that, and then all the actual coding ends up coming out of VI just using C++. I don't use Eclipse or any of those other bigger IDEs. Again, that's just how my workflow is, but I think, you know, we discussed this offline on email yep. as well, and I'm hopeful we can do a tutorial on that. Maybe if we have some other listeners out there who do use some of these bigger IDEs and maybe use other toolkits, GTK, etc., let us know. I mean, obviously, I'll talk about Git. We used SVN for a long time. We're on Git now, so I can help contribute some to the doc for that. But it would be neat to have some other people's perspectives, too, because my situation may be different from yours, and you may hate VI. I mean, what do you use again, Alan?
I use Nano, mostly.
Nano, okay.
It's not quite an IDE, but... if I'm doing more complicated stuff, especially when I'm working with DocBook and the syntax sugar and stuff makes it easier, I use Komodo Edit, which okay. I'm currently working on getting the port updated for, but it seems like it depends on that CentOS 6.5 stuff. Although PCBSD Tree has that now, does it?
We did for a okay. while in an experimental branch. We took it out because it was proving unstable in some ways.
Right.
It broke like Flash plugins and whatnot in bad ways. But when it hits the tree again, it's some of those things have been fixed. Then yeah, we'll obviously.
I'm working on getting us a pair of interviews for that. One for the new Linux emulator and one for updating the ports tree with all the CentOS 6 and Fedora 19
nice.
Stuff.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to seeing that come in soon, by the way. But yeah, when we played with it ahead of time, it was like, I'm not ready to push that out to people and have other things break.
But also, I saw the greatest quote earlier today on IRC. Somebody was asking about the ZFS utility ZDB, which is the debugging tool. Mm-hmm. And Matt Aaron's quote after in the middle of the discussion was, when ZFS started development, there was only VI and an empty text file.
Yeah, that's about how you do it, right?
And then he started coding, and that's how ZFS started.
Somebody just asked in chat if I use VI or Vim, and sorry, VI.
So I guess you're technically using NVI, right?
Yeah, it's the one in the base system.
NVI is the one that's in the FreeBSD base system, which is not VI, but it is definitely not Vim either.
Yeah, yeah. You know, I don't mind Vim, you know, and I fire it up from time to time when maybe the color... You know, stuff helps a little bit, or I need the GUI app, but
like,
for the most part, I don't use it that
if
often.
If I'm editing a config file or making a small change, I use Nano. If I'm doing something bigger and I'm sitting at, if I'm doing the development on the machine I'm on, rather than doing it, you know, over SSH on some other machine. Then I'll use Komodo Edit, especially for like stuff like XML, because when you write the opening tag, it places the closing tag behind your cursor so that you don't forget it.
Yeah, sure.
And stuff like that. Or autocomplete for attributes and stuff. And, it's great. Although the language it's the least helpful for is actually C. It's great for everything else.
Oh, man.
With C, there's just no helping you. Sorry.
Yeah. Sorry. You're on your own, dude.
Yeah.
Well, he says also, as it stands, most of his exposure ends at using Nano or EE to type code, using CC to compile, executing the resulting A.L, and messing around with make. So he said it's not much, I know, but hey, that's a lot of what we use too. Yeah. We use QMake for Qt stuff just to make, because it generates make files automatically, which is a little handier. But we could definitely talk about the tutorial.
Yeah, that's basically the extent of what programming I've done. It's usually make a small change to an if statement, recompile. Yay!
Yeah, done, it worked, okay.
Yes, or comment out this line that's making it break. Does it work now? Really bad.
So he also says, as always, he'll continue to be grateful for the show. Please keep up the good work. And he says, so hopefully someday he'll make it to a conference and buy us a drink. Cool. And we will take you up on that. So see if you can make your way out there, Paul. Cool. Yeah. Okay. Next question we have is from Tom, asking a question about upgrades. He says, first of all, thank you for the interesting and always educational show. You recharge my BSD battery every week.
Cool.
Well, thank you. We both enjoy doing that. He says he does not trust himself to always install security updates on his FreeBSD server. If it's not automatic, I'll probably forget at some point, which I can understand that. And we all sometimes can get lazy.
Luckily,
especially if you got multiple boxes.
Yes, like 80 something. But luckily, if you subscribe to the right mailing list, you'll get an email reminder when it's time to install one.
Definitely. He says he already has a FreeBSD update cron running as a cron job, but he's concerned about his third-party packages, and running package upgrade automatically doesn't feel safe. Well,
there's a solution.
I feel you there, because, again, you just run that blindly. Who knows what version it's up? I mean, somebody could have thrown something new in the porch tree, and you're going from Apache this to that, and needs new config or new this or that. So I get that. He said, do you know of any way monitoring package audits so we can get email alerts to remind me to patch my software?
I think there's one built into the periodic reports. I think it's just disabled by default.
Yeah, I think you just need to enable that, because on one of my systems, I have turned that on, and I get periodic mail that says these packages are out of date.
So I think it's, a good reminder. Like something like package underscore audit underscore enable equals yes or something like that. Look in your etc defaults periodic.conf, which has every possible value defined, and find the one you want, and then copy it to etc periodic.conf and enable it, and that will make that be included in those emails. I think there's also a port that does something similar. I know Dan Lingilf, that hosts BSD Can, was posting on his blog. He's got his setup with Nagios. So if you have a lot of servers, you can actually set up Nagios to alert and keep nagging you when there's an update that you need to install, and it not stop nagging you until you actually install the patches.
I see some package version flags you can enable that'll show you which versions are out of date and which index file to use. So there's definitely some options in there. I mean, if worse came to worse, just add another cron script like you did for your first one and just run package upgrade -n so it doesn't actually do anything. Email yourself the results. Like, that would be an easy solution as well. So you can go, it's going to try to upgrade these if I do it, and then decide if you're going to run that or not. Cool. Okay. Well, hopefully we answered your question there, Tom. And that brings us to the end of our feedback and questions for the week. So, of course, as we close the show, we want to let you know that all the tutorials are going to be posted in their entirety at bsdnow.tv, so you have to go take a look at that. Also, send your questions, comments, show ideas, topics, or stories you want mentioned on the show to feedback@bsdnow.tv. That's really the only place we monitor, so try and send it there. Don't use social media or whatever, because we may not see it. So, if you'd like to come on for an interview or have a tutorial you'd like to see, or if you're willing to, better yet, even write one, that would be great. Go ahead and just email us. Let us know. TJ, our producer, will probably be very happy to be in touch with you.
Yep.
So just a reminder, if you're using VND or VNC or VNconfig on OpenBSD for encryption, it's being retired for 5.7. So start planning to migrate your data to SoftRAID soon. Yep.
And there's also been three security advisories for FreeBSD covering SendMail, Ktrace, and PAM. I think one or two of those can be mitigated by flipping some variables rather than having to reboot. But I think the switching the variable for the ktrace one has side effects, which can break some apps. So it depends on what apps you're using. But all three of those advisories have details on how to upgrade, and you should do that quickly.
For those watching live, we're pushing out our updates via FreeBSD update here shortly after the show, actually. That's cool. The very next thing I got to go work on. So, of course, you can watch live Wednesdays at 2 p.m. Eastern, 1800 UTC. So join us. We love to have you watch live, and it's fun being able to chat with you guys in the chat room or respond to that live as well, which is something we can't necessarily do on Fridays. But, we're glad to have you guys with us this week. We'll look forward to an exciting new show next week. See you then. Like most of the other BSDs, OpenBSD supports multiple ways of installing third-party software. Both their ports and package systems were originally taken for FreeBSD, but of course they've changed quite a bit since then. So if you're familiar with FreeBSD versions, you'll notice some similarities, but also some interesting differences. Both ways make it really easy to install, remove, and update programs that you may want to add to the base system. OpenBSD handles port branches a bit differently, though. There are current and stable branches that get security updates, and the release branch, which is frozen before a release every 6 months. You can and should run the stable branch supports on either a release or stable system, but the current branch will only work on current, of course. Things must be kept in sync with the base system version. So go ahead and take it away, Alan. Let's show us how to do this.
So today's tutorial, we're doing the OpenBSD package system. So the first thing we need to do is get a copy of the ports tree, which you can either do with SVN, like so, or if you want to be a bit quicker, you can grab the snapshot. In this case, this will download the version for your whatever version of OpenBSD you're using automatically, or you can type it in manually, 5.5, and you'll see it'll fetch that. Then you can also download the signature and then use Signify to verify that signature. And what that'll do is make sure that this is actually a signed release of the ports tree from the OpenBSD team. Anyway, once that's done, you can then extract the tarball, like so. Now, I've already done those steps because otherwise it was going to take a long time. And then the other thing you can do is once you go into the ports tree, you can use CVS to update that as well. That way you have all the latest stuff. But anyway, now to get to the meat of the matter, if we actually want to install a port, if we just go, say, www newsbooter, now we can do make install clean, and it will download and install the application, just like you would expect. Or some applications, like for example Vim, have different flavors. If we make show equals flavors, you can see that we have a number of different flavors here, including the NoX11 one, which might be what we're after. So we can just set the environment variable flavor equals NoX11, then make install clean, and that will download and install Vim with the NoX11 setting. Or some packages have what are called sub-packages. So if we look at, for example, Pigeon, the instant messaging program, if we make show multi-packages, we see that there's actually three different versions. There's Pigeon main, which is the main instant messaging client, Pigeon-Finch, which is the simple command line interface, or Pigeon-libpurple, which is the library that allows you to use Pigeon in another program. So we can just say subpackage equals -finch, make install clean, and that'll install Pigeon-libfinch, or Pigeon-finch, which should give us the command line version. The other thing you can do is install packages, which are pre-compiled ports. To do this, the first thing you need to do is set the environment variable package_path, which you'll see just points to some FTP mirror and the version of OpenBSD you're using and your architecture. Then simply package underscore add minus I for install Vim, and it will download and install Vim and any dependencies that are required. In this case, because if you remember, Vim had multiple different flavors, we get a list of those flavors. And we can choose, for example, Vim-NoX11, and that'll give us the version of Vim that doesn't have a dependency on X11. Or we could have chosen the version that has the Perl, Python, and Ruby bindings. Now, if we do package underscore info, we can see the list of installed packages. Because ports are sorted into categories, and sometimes it's not always obvious where something will be, you can also do make search key equals vnstat or some other application that you're looking for, and it will find where it is in the ports tree. In this case, we can see it's in the net category. You can also search by keywords, like the word traffic, and you'll see you'll find flag route and vnstat and traffd and TCP replay and softfloaty and all your other stuff that has to do with traffic. So you can also search by keyword in case you can't remember the name of the program that you're looking for. There are also different versions of the ports tree. There's the release version, which comes with your release, a stable version, which has updates, and a current version if you're running the current version of OpenBSD. There's also an infrastructure category in the ports tree. If we look, there's binaries in there, including out of date, which will search all your installed packages and find any that are out of date that need to be updated. Then you can either go to a specific port, like say PNG, and do make update, which will update that port for you. Or you can package add minus U, which will scan all the packages, find binary updates for them, and install those binary updates. Then you can just package delete, say Vim. And this will get rid of Vim. Then you can package delete minus A, and this will look for any dependencies that are no longer used and remove them. In this case, we don't need getText or libiconv anymore because we've uninstalled Vim. So now when we look at package info, we're down back to just this simple package add rules. And we can reinstall Vim. And this will pull back in the dependencies for Vim, like libiconv and getText. And so that's about it for how the OpenBSD ports and packages system works. It's very similar to the port system on FreeBSD, although there are a couple differences with the way you choose. Rather than having options for a port, you have flavors and sub-packages instead. But in general, it's not that different. And that's all for this week. Hope to see you again next week.